Hey everybody, KMO here with part two of the perception gap. So I opened there with a quote from Thomas Jefferson talking about how the man who reads nothing at all is better informed than the man who reads nothing but newspapers. What was he talking about? Was he praising ignorance? Well, in Jefferson's day, newspapers were more like what we would consider blogs to be. They were very opinionated. They made no pretense whatsoever at professional journalistic objectivity, the pretense that the journalist and the editorial staff at the paper don't have a position, aren't taking sides, you know, don't have shared interests with any, you know, of a competing variety of players in the social scene that they cover. So what about the news? What does staying informed, what does making an effort to consume news media do to one's perception gap? And again, the perception gap is the distance between what you believe your opponents believe and what they actually believe. We tend to assume that people who don't share our views are far more extreme in the views that they hold than they actually are. So, people taking this perception gap quiz were asked, how much news do you consume? The options were hardly at all, don't know, only now and then, some of the time, and most of the time. And as you can see, the more news somebody consumed, the greater the perception gap, the greater the distortion in their ability to determine what other people believe. Now, all sources of media are not created equal. Some are more distorting than others. So if you'll recall yesterday, Republicans in the aggregate, you know, with no distinctions made between everybody who considers themselves a Republican, Republicans in the aggregate distort the other side's views more than Democrats do. But it depends a lot on the sorts of media that they consume. Have a look at this chart. The most distorting lens through which to see the world are sources like Breitbart, The Drudge Report, RedState.com, or AM Talk Radio, which is and has been for decades now. And I think this is huge because AM Talk Radio predates the World Wide Web. So, you know, my dad was listening to Rush Limbaugh in the 80s. I remember it drove me nuts. So talk radio programs like Rush Limbaugh and Sean Hannity and, you know, other online sources like Slate, BuzzFeed, Daily Kos, Huffington Post, these are all openly opinionated. They have strong bias. It is in no way difficult to see the bias of these media outlets. And as you can see, people who rely on them to inform their view of the world have a very distorted view of the world. Particularly, they have a very distorted belief about what the other side believes. Now, Fox News, I mean, you'll hear Fox News held up as, you know, this ultimate evil in the world that is spreading conservative lies. But look at Fox News. It's right here in the middle of this chart. It adds less than 5% to somebody's perception gap. And what is the, you know, the least harmful source of news? Religious news broadcasting. Things like the Christian Post and the Christian News Network. Now, they're not at the very bottom of this list because I describe them as the least harmful. They have the least distorting effect. But ABC, CBS, and NBC, the major network news programs, actually inform people. They actually decrease the perception gap of people who consume this media. Now, I remember when I was a kid in the late 70s and early 80s, I watched a whole lot of TV. Some days I would get home from school and I would watch an afternoon movie and then maybe some cartoons and then maybe reruns of old shows like Gilligan's Island or Star Trek. And I'd just keep on watching the TV right until the evening news came on. And, you know, the network news would come on and it was about a half hour. I think it was a half hour. And then it was followed by local news, which was another half hour. So there was an hour of news that I watched. But if a national news program only has a half hour to fill, they can't go very deep into any particular story. You're going to get the main headlines of the day. You're going to get, you know, national weather. You're going to get a couple of fluff pieces, and none of it's very deep. So there really isn't that much opportunity to distort the picture. And what's more, it was very easy to keep track of all three news networks and, you know, what sort of perspective they offered. So if any one of them was really out of step with the other two, that would be, you know, jarring. That would be very noticeable. So they all sort of policed one another and they maintained a common presentation, which apparently was not nearly as distorting as you think it might be. You know, that's a moral hazard, to be the single source of, you know, the official narrative that people had access to, you know, and could make reference to and use to inform themselves in their conversations with other people. It seems like that would be, you know, the temptation to distort would be huge. But in fact, with the three players policing one another, the reverse was actually true. Which isn't to say there wasn't bias. Of course, there was bias. But not like today. And, you know, I stress the short nature of these national, these daily national news broadcasts. Because with 24 hours to fill, a network like CNN, they either have to go into great depth on something, which generally they don't, or they have to cover a lot of fluff, which they do, and they have to repeat themselves a lot, which they do, but also, I mean, it still leaves a lot of time in the day to fill. They just go and they find experts to come and sit in front of the camera and flap their lips. And, you know, the more time you give over to experts flapping their lips, the more sort of esoteric you get. And if you have multiple news outlets, each sort of randomly diverging into these, you know, different branches of esoterica, you're going to get some very divergent worldviews. Now, even bigger than what news source you consume, this is the bit that really struck me. Education. The people with the most distorted view of the other side are uneducated Republicans. People who don't even have a high school education. They didn't even graduate high school. But they listen to Sean Hannity. They listen to Rush Limbaugh. They read the Drudge Report. They have a very distorted view. Whereas, if you have no high school education at all, and you're a Democrat, you have less of a perception gap than any other form, any other educational level that Democrats might achieve. Have a look at this graph. No high school, your perception gap looks to be around 10, maybe less than 10. And then graduating from high school and having some college, you know, like less than an associate's degree, but you've been to college a little bit. Going to college a little bit actually seems to drop you down. It seems to lessen your perception gap. But then once you're past like the associate's degree, you know, 2 years of college or more, the more education you achieve, the higher your educational, you know, achievement level as a Democrat, the more distorted your view becomes. Why is that? And it's not the case with Republicans. You know, uneducated Republicans have the greatest distortion, but thereafter, your level of education doesn't really seem to make that big a difference. Why is that? Well, the higher you get in educational achievement as a Democrat, the more you self-select in terms of other people that you talk to. If you're in grad school and you're a Democrat, you might not ever talk to a Republican except when you go home, you know, for Thanksgiving dinner and crazy Uncle Milton is there spouting his racist garbage. And when I say crazy Uncle Milton, I'm visualizing my now deceased father's father-in-law. One of the most racist people I've ever met in my life. But think about the perspective of somebody who is right-leaning, but who has a university education, or, you know, even more than that, is a grad student, or even a professor at a university. They can't really self-select and surround themselves only with other conservatives. If you're on a university campus, basically you have no choice but to interact with liberals. You know, most of your fellow faculty members will be Democrats. If you're a grad student, most of your fellow grad students will be Democrats. You just can't isolate yourself, not in the real world, but you can online. So tomorrow I will finish up this series talking about the effects of social media on the perception gap. Talk to you then.